Third unit of this chapter, sexual reproduction in flowering plant is pollination. Okay. Now, what is pollination? So, pollination is transfer of pollen grain from anther to stigmatic surface. Okay. So, basically, it is transfer of pollen on where? To the stigma. Now, depending upon what is the source of pollen, we divide pollination into three different types. First is autogamy. Okay. Now, autogamy means self-pollination. That means pollen from a flower is transferred to the stigmatic surface of same flower. Okay. That is referred as autogamy. Now, for autogamy to take place, there must be a synchrony between dehiscence of anther and receptivity of stigma. That means when anther dehisce or split open, that will result in release of pollen grain. At the same time, that the stigmatic surface must be receptive for that particular pollen grain. That means there must be synchrony in pollen lesion stigma receptivity. That will promote self-pollination. And along with that, these flower must lie close to one another, or these stigma and anther must lie close to one another. Now, there are various methods through which this process of self-pollination or autogamy can be promoted. Explicitly, it is not mentioned in NCERT, but it is important to know that. First is homogamy. Homogamy means when anther ruptures, stigma become receptive. That means both the sex organ matures at same time. Then there is a thing known as clistogamy or clistogamous flower. Clistogamy means those flower which never open. As in case of viola, common pansy, oxalis and comelina. Okay. Here flower will never open. So it will assure seed set even in the absence of pollinating agent, because no pollinating agent is required here. So pollination will take place whether pollinating agent is there or not. Okay. Then in case of these three, that is viola, oxalis and comelina, along with this clistogamous flower, we also have chasmogamous flower. Chasmogamous flower means those flower which exposes themselves to pollinating agent. So second thing which will promote the self-pollination autogamy is clistogamy. Then third thing is bud pollination. Bud pollination means before the opening of flower, pollination will take place. That thing occurs in case of pea. Okay. So in case of pea, pollination takes place before the opening of flower. And that this is one of the reason because of which Mendel selected pea as an experimental material. So this is your autogamy. Next is gytnogamy. Gytnogamy means here there is only one plant. Okay. Plant is one, but on that particular plant, male and female flower is different. So this is a plant. Suppose this is male flower and this is female flower. So from this male flower, pollen will be transferred to this female flower. So ecologically, or functionally, it is cross-pollination because two different flowers are involved. But genetically, it is similar to autogamy. Why genetically it is similar to autogamy? Because here plant is single, on which male and separate male and female flower is there. Example is maize, castor. These are example of this gytnogamy. Then third is genogamy. Genogamy means cross pollination. That means there are two different flowers are involved which are present on two different plants. So ecologically as well as genetically it is cross pollination. Now there are various methods through which this process of cross pollination is promoted, like dichogamy. Dichogamy means here male and female reproductive part matures at different time. In homogamy, it matures at same time and it promotes cell pollination. Dichogamy, male and female part will mature at different time. Then heterostyly. Heterostyly means here a style of different length is present. In flowers, we have different length of style. One flower have long style, another flower will have short style. So another will have intermediate size style. So it will promote the cross pollination. Then harcogamy. Here physical barrier is present which prevents cell pollination. Okay. Then we have prepotency. Prepotency means when pollen of same flower lands on the stigmatic surface and pollen of another flower lands on the stigmatic surface, then the rate of germination of non-cell pollen is faster than the cell pollen. And the most important from which maximum question have been asked is self incompatibility. Self incompatibility means cell pollen fails to germinate on stigmatic surface. That means it will be rejected. Or if it germinates on a stigmatic surface, it fails to transverse styler region. That means either it will be rejected here, or if it germinates, then this pollen won't be able to reach the ovule. It will be rejected in the styler region. And this self incompatibility is genetically determined. Okay? It is genetically determined. So we are through with different types of pollination, and what are the thing which promotes these kind of pollination. Now next is agent of pollination. Next topic is agent of pollination. Okay. Now so pollinating agent is broadly divided into two different category, that is abiotic and biotic. Okay. Now abiotic agent includes wind and water. Okay. And biotic agent includes insect, bird, bat, snake, snail, primates, reptiles, etc. Okay. So now among abiotic agent, wind is most common pollinating agent, whereas among biotic agent it is insect, and among insect it is bee, honeybee, which is most common pollinating agent. Now wind pollination is referred as anemophily, water pollination is hydrophily, insect entomophily, bird ornithophily, bat caryptrophily, snake ophiophily, snail malacophily. Okay, so these are the different names of pollination by different agents. Okay, now as we know, plants are pollinated by different kinds of pollinating agent. So in order to get pollinated by these kind of pollinating agent, plants show certain adaptations. Okay. Now, those plants which are pollinated by wind, okay, shows what kind of adaptation. Here, pollen grains are light and non-sticky in nature, so that they can be transported by wind current. They are light in weight, non-sticky, so that they can be transported by wind current. Okay. Then they have well exposed stamen, okay, so that pollen can be easily dispersed by wind. Then they have large feathery stigma in order to catch the pollen grain. Okay. Then number of ovule is highly reduced, and that generally it is single ovule. Then flowers are packed into inflorescence. Okay. Now for example, maize, here the corn cob, the tassel you see is nothing but a stigma. The hair, which is nothing, is stigma and style, which waves in the wind in order to trap the pollen grain which is present in air, because the transport of pollen grain through the wind is non-directional. So probability of coming to of pollen grain to the female flower is very less. That's why the number of ovule is highly reduced. Then next is wind, water. So pollination by water is not very common. Okay, it is confined only to 30 genera and most of them are monocot. Okay, now this pollination by water can take place on the surface. We call it epihydrophily, or inside the water. We call it hyphydrophily. Okay, now hyphydrophily. This epihydrophily takes place in case of Vallisneria. That means in case of Vallisneria, pollination takes place on the surface of water. Whereas in case of seagrass or Jostera, pollination takes place inside the water. Now, those plants which are pollinated by water shows following adaptations. Okay, what are the adaptation? Long ribbon-shaped pollen, so that they can be passively carried out by water in order to minimize the resistance. Then they have mucilaginous covering, okay, over the pollen surface in order to prevent wetting of pollen. So basically long ribbon shaped pollen grain and mucilaginous covering on pollen. Now one question is very important here. It is not necessary that every aquatic plant is pollinated by water. Large number of aquatic plant like Elisma, Nymphaea, this question have been asked I think in 2016 or 17. Elisma, Nymphaea, they are pollinated by either insect or wind. So it is not mandatory that every aquatic plant will be pollinated by water. So we are through with abiotic pollinating agent. Okay. Now, next is biotic pollinating agent. This is an example of pollination in Vallisneria. This diagram is important. Okay. What happens when this male flower gets matured? It comes in this on the surface of water, and this female flower which has coiled axis gets uncoiled and come to the surface of water. During the process of uncoiling, a whorl is created. This is whorl, and in this whorl this male flower gets trapped, and then pollen gets deposited on the stigmatic surface and pollination is carried out. This is in case of Vallisneria. So in case of Vallisneria, pollination on the surface of water, and here complete male flower is transferred. That means this male flower itself acts as pollen grain because it is transferred during process of pollination. Okay, now next, biotic agent. So most important biotic agent is insect. Okay, pollination by insect is most common, and among insect it is bee. Now those plants which are pollinated by insect are chasmogamous. Means they expose themselves to pollinating agent. Okay, they are brightly colored, fragrant, and they have nectar. Now this pollination is a service which is provided by these pollinator. So in return, flower provides fuller rewards in terms of food, that is pollen or nectar, or safe place to lay eggs. So this plant pollinator relationship is very intricate, very intimate. Okay, and they tend to co-evolve because one is not able to complete its life cycle in the absence of another. For example, there is a plant known as yucca, and there is a yucca moth, Pronuba. This yucca moth lays egg in flower of yucca, and during this process it carries out pollination. If one is absent, another won't be able to complete its life cycle. Then what happens sorry then those plants which are pollinated by bees or sorry flies or beetle emits foul smell. So that foul smell will attract flies or beetle and they will carry out pollination. Then Amorphophallus, which has tallest flower, okay, sorry, Amorphophallus, which has tallest flower, provide safe place, okay, it is 6 feet long height, okay, for its pollinator to lay eggs, okay. So this is insect pollination. Now apart from that, I have mentioned other types of pollination, but that is not very important for you people. For exam point of view, if you want to go into that detail, you can go refer to the original video, okay, which is available with you people, okay. Now then next is outbreeding devices. So what is outbreeding devices? Outbreeding devices means those devices which promotes cross pollination. I have discussed that is self-incompatibility, dichogamy, heterostyly, harcogamy, and then unisexuality. There is one thing that is referred as unisexuality or diaceae, that is either male or female flower is present, and this condition prevents, this question have been asked, this condition prevents both autogamy and gitanogamy. If plant is dioecious, that means either male or female flower is present in plant, then okay, then what will happen? Neither autogamy nor gitanogamy will take place. Next topic that is part of this pollination, that is pollen pistil interaction. Okay, not much question have been asked from this part, but this is very important part concept wise. Anytime question can be asked. Now what is pollen pistil interaction? Landing of pollen grain do not guarantee pollination do not guarantee transfer of right type of pollen on stigmatic surface. Okay, so what happens when pollen lands on a stigmatic surface? There is communication between stigmatic surface and pollen grain, okay, and this communication takes place in form of chemical. That means pollen will release certain chemical, stigmatic surface will release certain chemical, and those chemical will interact. If pollen is compatible, it is allowed to germinate. If pollen is not compatible, it is rejected. So the sum total of all the events from landing of pollen grain on a stigmatic surface till the entry of pollen tube inside the ovule is referred as pollen pistil interaction, and it takes place in form of chemical communication. Okay, now when pollen lands on a stigmatic surface, okay, when this pollen lands on this stigmatic surface, what will happen? It gets hydrated, okay, and it will release certain chemical, then stigma will release certain chemical. Now this rejection can take place either on a stigmatic surface, if you looked into this pollen or this pollen, they are rejected here on a stigmatic surface, or they are rejected in styler region, and this pollen is able to enter inside the embryo sac via ovule, okay, because it is compatible. Okay, now during this process, two things are involved, two chemicals, that is boron and calcium. Now boron is released by stigmatic surface, it is not there here in NCERT, it is there in mineral nutrition. Boron is released by stigmatic surface and it helps in sugar mobilization, whereas calcium is released by pollen grain itself. So more the concentration of calcium, better will be the pollen tube growth. So more the number of pollen grain, higher will be the concentration of calcium and better will be the pollen tube growth, and that is referred as crowding effect. We call it crowding effect. That means calcium is required for pollen tube growth, okay, For pollen germination, boron is required. Now, this calcium is contributed by pollen itself. So, more the number of pollen grain, higher will be the calcium concentration. So, better will be the pollen tube growth. And that is referred as crowding effect. More the number, better will be the germination. Now, now this pollen tube will enter inside the embryo sac. Okay? First, it will enter inside the ovule. Generally, ovule, it enters through micropyle. It is known as porogamy. But it can also enter through chalazal end. Inside the ovule, it is known as chalazogamy. As in case of this casuarina. Or it can enter through integument or funicle. And it is referred as mesogamy. Now, so inside the ovule, it can enter through micropyle or integument or funicle or chalazal end, but entry of pollen tube inside this embryo sac is always through micropyle end. No other path can be followed by the pollen tube. Now, this is a sectional diagram. Here we have pollen tube. Now, when I have already discussed this, when pollen lands on stigmatic surface, it is two cells, then generative cell will divide to form two male gamete. So what will happen? This pollen tube will enter inside the embryo sac, and this entry is guided by this filiform apparatus. Okay. Now this pollen tube contains two male gamete and one vegetative nucleus, which will degenerate later on. Okay. Now, as this pollen tube will enter inside this, the polar nuclei, which is present in the central cell, will start fusing, and now they will fuse to form secondary nucleus, and now one of the synergid will degenerate. One of the synergid will degenerate, and now pollen tube will release its content on this degenerated synergid, which consists of degenerated vegetative nucleus, two male gamete, and very small amount of cytoplasm. Okay. Okay, so I have discussed this. Then there is a topic that is cross-pollination or artificial hybridization. So knowledge of this pollen-pistil interaction is manipulated in agriculture in order to create desirable hybrid, and we call it artificial hybridization. Now this process of artificial hybridization, if flower is bisexual, involves first step, that is emasculation. That is conversion of bisexual flower into female flower. Then that emasculated flower is bagged. That is referred as bagging. Why? In order to prevent pollination by undesirable pollen grain. Then pollen is grain is connected from desirable pollen male plant. And then if stigma become receptive, then this pollen grain is dusted on a stigmatic surface and it is rebagged. And if flower is unisexual, then this process of emasculation is not required. We do not require emasculation. Okay. So we are through with unit 3.